السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All praise is due to Allah, the Great, the Mighty. We praise Him for the blessings, and we also praise Him whilst in trial and tribulations. I bear witness that no one has the right to be worshipped except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I also bear witness that Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his servant and messenger, the leader of the pious and the master of those who came before us and those who come towards the end. May the peace and blessings be upon the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And may the peace and blessings be also on the companions and those who followed them until the day of resurrection. So my dear brothers, congratulations. Yes, I would like to congratulate you all on being given this another opportunity to live Ramadan. Another opportunity to earn great multiples of deeds through fasting, through prayers, through giving in charity. Another opportunity really to gain Allah's forgiveness. Imam Ahmad narrated that Abu Hurairah, may Allah be pleased with him, said, two men became Muslim with the Prophet, peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. One of them was martyred. He died as a shaheed. And the other remained for another year. Talha ibn Ubaidillah, one of the companions, radiallahu anhu, said, I was shown paradise, meaning in a dream, he was shown paradise. And in it, I saw that the one who was delayed, the one who was given another year, was admitted before the martyr, was admitted to paradise before the shaheed. I was surprised by that. So the next morning I told the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam about that. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, did he not fast Ramadan after he was gone, meaning after the first one was gone? So the second one was delayed, was given an opportunity to fast an extra Ramadan and pray 6,000 rak'ahs, or such a number of rak'ahs, the prayers of one year. So this is the reason why this person entered paradise before this shaheed. This hadith is classed as sahih by Shaykh al-Albani. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also said, if any Muslim comes out of Ramadan without gaining forgiveness and goodness, he is a real loser. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us. So I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us all amongst those who come out of Ramadan gaining forgiveness and goodness. I also have the pleasure of introducing our brother Wajdi Akari, who will take us through a Muslim's typical day in Ramadan. Brother Wajdi, he works at the Jeddah Da'wah Center as a caller to Islam, or propagator. And at the same time, he is also an English language instructor. Jazallah khair, our brother Wajdi, yani he gives many lectures or many lessons at different sites. Some of them that I'm going to be mentioning here, one of them is giving an explanation of the book Al-Aqidah Al-Wasitiyah for Imam Ibn Taymiyyah. And this is every Saturday in Al-Mushrifah, Hayy Al-Mushrifah branch. This is between Maghrib and Isha prayer. He's also giving lessons in Tafsir. And this is in Al-Salama branch every Friday from 9:30 until 10:30 in the morning. These two lessons are for our brothers only. He is also giving explanation of the three fundamental principles of Usul al-Thalatha. And this is in Masjid al-Aziziyah, and this is for both men and women. And this is every Tuesday. And this is also, we shouldn't forget that he's also giving Friday khutbahs once to twice per month. Jazallah khair. You can find out more about the different lectures or talks, audios, videos, khutbahs, on the website www.onewaytoparadise.net. One way to paradise is spelled out in letters, so there's no numbers. onewaytoparadise.net. So I leave the floor open to our brother Wajdi. Jazakumullah khair.
إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. All praise is due to Allah, and as such we praise Him. We seek Allah's forgiveness and we ask Allah's assistance. And we seek refuge with Allah from our evil souls and our bad deeds. Verily, whomever Allah guides, no one can lead astray. And whoever Allah allows to go astray because they do not want any guidance, then no one can guide. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وسلم تسليما كثيرا. And I be witness that there is no deity worthy of our worship except Allah alone with no partners. And I be witness that Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم is his servant and his messenger. May Allah exalt his mention, grant him peace, his companions and all those who follow them on their righteous path until the day of judgment. Brothers in Islam and sisters in Islam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has favored particular locations and times or seasons due to his mercy and generosity. And among the times that Allah has made blessed and virtuous is the time of Ramadan, the month of Ramadan in particular. As the brother, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward him with goodness, had reminded us with some of the virtues and some of the narrations from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which should incite each and every one of us to take advantage of what is approaching. Actually, Ramadan is just at the doorstep. And whenever you have a guest, people are of two kinds. Either you honor your guest, or you dishonor your guest. And so Ramadan is a guest that will be approaching and coming into our homes. Some of us will take advantage of this guest, honor him, treat him accordingly, and make the best out of the situation. Whereas others, whom Allah had decreed to be among those who will be deprived because of some evil within us, we hope that we're not one of those individuals. They will not take advantage of the month, and they will turn it into something else. As we will see in the lecture, we'll give some examples of how people have misused the time and the blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has bestowed upon us concerning the month of Ramadan. It is sufficient for me and you to know concerning Ramadan that the Quran was revealed in this particular month, or in this approaching month, inshallah. We're so excited, we're speaking as if we're in Ramadan already. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس وبينات من الهدى والفرقان فمن شهد منكم الشهر فليصم ومن كان مريضا أو على سفر فعدة من أيام أخر يريد الله بكم اليسر ولا يريد بكم العسر وَلِتُكْمِلُوا الْعِدَّةِ وَلِتُكَبِّرُوا اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. The month of Ramadan in which was revealed the Qur'an, guidance for mankind. And we say the Qur'an is guidance for everyone, but not everyone is qualified to be guided. It guides those who want guidance, and those who don't want guidance will not be guided, even though the Qur'an in and within itself is a guide. And Allah says, and clear proofs of the guidance and the criterion between right and wrong. So whoever is present, meaning he's not traveling, and he cites the crescent of the month of Ramadan, then let him observe fast. And whoever is ill or on a journey, then a number of days are to be fasted to make up for those that were missed. Verily Allah intends goodness for you, and He does not want to make things difficult, so that you may make up the number of days. Magnify Allah for having guided you to Islam, and so you may be grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this ayah has a number of benefits if we were to pause with it. But just quickly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned that He intends ease for us, and He does not intend to make things difficult. And so this is a general principle in Islam. Anytime there's difficulty, then automatically there's ease. And in this case, if you are traveling or if you are ill, then you may fast after Ramadan is over to make up for the days that you have missed. But then the ayah ends, in order for us to magnify Allah for having guided us, and this is a blessing that cannot be expressed in words or even feelings. It is something beyond our ability. The fact that out of the billions and billions of human beings in the current days we're living and in the prior times, the ancient times, not that many people were guided to the truth. It's always been a selected few whom Allah has guided, and the rest were led astray due to their evil ways and so on and so forth. So the fact that Allah guided me and you to Islam is a blessing, which Allah is reminding us that we should magnify Allah accordingly. Then we should be grateful to Allah. And according to the ulama, being grateful is not simply saying, thank you, Allah, as you may hear often, thank you, Allah. It is a lot more than that. Being grateful to Allah is first acknowledging in your heart that this blessing which you have is strictly from Allah, and no human being is involved in any way, shape, or form, even though there may be tools for you to receive it. But ultimately, the rizq, the provision, is from Allah. Secondly, then you, with your statements, you say, you indicate that you are appreciative concerning that which Allah has given you. And the last part, which is the most fundamental, is that you utilize these blessings in ways pleasing to Allah. That's what shukr really means, being grateful. Now, if you do so, وَإِذْ أَذَنَ رَبُّكُمْ لَإِنْ شَكَرْتُمْ لَأَزِيدَنَّكُمْ. And your Lord has proclaimed, if you show thankfulness, Allah will increase you. And so, the scholars say, Ramadan is around the corner. The first thing we need to do is show thankfulness to Allah. In case we live, in case you are alive when they sight the moon, and it is the first night of Taraweeh, and you're alive, the first thing that one must do in his heart is acknowledge this blessing from Allah and be thankful as a result of that. And this is already an opening for us to receive more blessings from Allah, because Allah promised that if we do so, then He shall increase us. This was one virtue based on the ayah. The hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which was narrated by Bukhari and Muslim, the hadith of Abu Huraira, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, إِذَا جَاءَ رَمَضَانَ فُتِّحَتْ أَبْوَابُ الْجَنَّةِ وَغُلِّقَتْ أَبْوَابُ النَّارِ وَصُفِّدَتُ الشَّيَاطِينَ. وفي رواية لابن ماجة وابن خزيمة والترمذي وصححها الألباني رحمه الله، وينادي مناد يا باغي الخير أقبل ويا باغي الشر أقصر ولله عتقاء من النار وذلك كل ليلة. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when Ramadan arrives, the doors of the heavens, the paradise in particular, are open, and the doors of the hellfire are closed, and then the devils are chained, so they will not be able to whisper as often as they do in our daily lives. This is why you see the most wicked of people suddenly become righteous in Ramadan. Unfortunately, some of them, when Ramadan is over, that they go back to their old ways. But still, the point being, in Ramadan, you see a major change among the Muslims. You try to go to the masjid at the time of Salah, and you will see people you've never seen before. And you know, suddenly the masjid cannot accommodate the brothers who pray, even though just the day before, you know, there was only two rows in Salat al-Isha or Fajr. This is something that everybody witnesses. I'm not giving you any new information. Now, in another narrative that was authenticated by Shaykh al-Albani and Ibn Majah al-Tirmidhi and Ibn Khuzaymah, rahimahullah al-jami'ah, the Prophet ﷺ continued to say, and a caller calls out, O seeker of good, proceed, come. And O seeker of evil, desist, stop. And Allah will redeem people from the hellfire, and that is every night. Meaning, any given night which you wind up fulfilling Allah's rights in that particular night by fasting the day properly and doing qiyam accordingly, as we will deal with inshallah eventually, then that might be the night where your name will be crossed off the list of those who will enter Jahannam, and then you will be among the inhabitants of Jannah. Any one of these nights, since we don't know, what do? We strive to make it every night. Every night we will do our best, so that night may be ours. Where, as the hadith says, there will be people who will be redeemed from the hellfire. And I don't understand, or if we all understand, how significant that is. And when we say that you're going to be saved from the fire, it's not like, you know, just a regular expression. You're talking about the hellfire, which the Prophet ﷺ described as being 69 times as powerful as the fire of our worldly life. 69 times. Now, bring a toaster here, and let the strongest brother put his hand, you know, in the toaster, just like a sandwich. No one will do it. Even a big, you know, big brother, muscular, he may punch someone, knock him out. But tell him, put your hand in the toaster, say, brother, thank you very much, I'm all right. And if he were to do so, he may weep afterwards and go to the hospital and may cry for a couple of weeks. Big brother. Because, you know, it hurts. Burning hurts. Now this is a toaster. There's no fire. It's just some electric. And so you can imagine what the hellfire is like. So being safe from the fire is not something that one takes for granted. We should actually ponder and reflect upon this particular statement of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. So we may act accordingly during the day of Ramadan. طيب. In Ramadan, there's Laylatul Qadr. And I will not be dealing with everything. Okay, I'm pretty much going to be dealing with the first 20 days. Because the last 10 days, they require something of their own. Right? Because there are many things related to the last 10 nights and Laylatul Qadr. So I cannot possibly accommodate all this in one lecture. And so I'm only going to be focusing on the 20 days. The other things, inshallah, you may read some material concerning that. And you know, familiarize yourself with what you should do at the last 10 nights. But predominantly we'll be dealing with the first 20 days, our day, but still as a virtual Ramadan, Laylatul Qadr, which is translated into English in a number of ways based on the interpretation of the scholars. The most accurate definition or translation is the night of honor or veneration, and another one, the night of decree. Some of them say the night of power is not really an adequate translation for the meaning, because the scholars, when discussing what is intended by Laylatul Qadr, they don't really approach this idea of power. But anyways, it's equal to how many months? 1,000 months. Now in our lives, we don't know such things. Have you ever been to a store, you know, where they told you, you know, buy one and we will give you 100,000 for free? We don't have such discounts. We may have some good sale every now and then, but something of this magnitude is beyond us. Yet one night is equal to 1,000 months in worship and virtue in the sight of Allah. And so it is befitting the believer to prepare him or herself accordingly for that night. But that's another discussion. طيب. Now where do we begin? When we say a typical day in Ramadan for the Muslim, one might wonder, when is the appropriate time to begin our day? So we can go step by step based on the ahadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So we may worship Allah in this upcoming month, not according to our forefathers or the way people do it back home, rather according to the authentic sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The time that was chosen is the last third of the night. The last third part of the night. This is based on a number of narrations. First of which, the hadith of Abu Hurairah and Bukhari, Muslim and others, where the Prophet said, يَنْزِلُ رَبُّنَا تَبَارَكَ وَتَعَالَى فِي إِلَى السَّمَاءِ الدُّنْيَا حِينَ يَبْقَى ثُلُثُ اللَّيْلِ الْآخِرِ فَيَقُولُ مَنْ يَدْعُونِي فَأَسْتَجِيبُ لَهُ مَنْ يَسْأَلُنِي فَأَعْطِيهِ مَنْ يَسْتَغْفِرُنِي فَأَغْفِرُ لَهُ. The Prophet said, our Lord Tabaraka wa Ta'ala descends to the lowest heaven, the heaven of our dunya, this life of ours, when the last third of the night comes in. And that is every night in a manner which befits Allah's majesty. لَيْسَ كَمِثْلِهِ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ السَّمِيعُ الْبَصِيرُ. There's nothing like unto him. And he is the all-hearing, all-seeing. So we don't have any images of how that happens. No one knows, and so we believe, and we don't go into any anthropomorphic understandings of how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala descends to the lowest heaven. But then the point being, Allah asks, is there anyone supplicating so I may respond to his supplication? Is there anyone asking for anything so I may grant it to him? Is there anyone seeking forgiveness so I may forgive him? It's beautiful. This is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the self-sufficient, the one who does not need us, as-samad, the absolute, the one who everyone needs and he needs none. يعني, for him azza wa jal, to be merciful and generous enough to make this particular offer, which sometimes your own boss doesn't give you. Your own family, they don't provide you with such lovely offers and such, you know, would you like anything so I can get it for you? You know, we don't hear this that often, even from the closest people to you. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one who does not need us in any way, shape or form, does that every night. And so it is advisable if we're able to be up at that time, that we are up at that time. بإذن الله عز وجل. We ask Allah to forgive us for our shortcomings. There's another narration from the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, which is also in Sahih Muslim. The hadith of Ibn Umar رضي الله عنه وأرضاه, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, أفضل الصلاة بعد الفريضة صلاة الليل. The best prayer after the obligatory prayer is that of the night prayer. So if you want to think in terms of the voluntary prayers like the Sunan and Rawatib before Dhuhr and after Maghrib and after Isha and so on and so forth, the best among them is Salatul Layl, the prayer that is done at night. Now Allah praised the believers who used to be busy worshipping Him during that time. He said, عز وجل, كَانُوا قَلِيلًا مِنَ اللَّيْلِ مَا يَهْجَعُونَ وَبِالْأَسْحَارِ هُمْ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ. They used to be in the habit of sleeping but little at night. And during the early dawn, they used to seek forgiveness from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Umar radiallahu anhu wa arda used to get up from the night and pray whatever Allah had decreed for him to pray. Then he used to wake up his family and say, and he recited the statement of Allah azza wa jal, وَأْمُرْ أَهْلَكَ بِالصَّلَاةِ وَاسْطَبِرْ عَلَيْهَا لَا نَسْأَلُكَ رِزْقًا نَحْنُ نَرْزُقُكَ وَالْعَاقِبَةُ لِلتَّقْوَى. Then he would recite the statement of Allah azza wa jal, which means interpretation of the meaning in English, and command your family to establish the prayer. And be patient upon doing so. We do not ask you for sustenance, we sustain you. And the good end is for righteousness. And the good end is for righteousness. So we begin then if we're able to do so. Now you may be thinking, Akhi, but we pray in Taraweeh, right? With the Imam. And so can we pray anything else at night? The scholars have given a number of fatawa concerning this, Shaykh bin Baz, Shaykh bin Uthaymeen rahimahullah, and even Al-Lajna al-Da'ima. If you follow the opinion that it is alright to exceed the 11 rak'at, if, because we want to accommodate brothers' fiqh positions, if it is valid, even though other scholars are of the position that, you know, 11 is it, then you don't go beyond it. But in case you do, then the scholars say there's no harm that you pray again during the night, but you don't pray witr again. So you pray 11 with the Imam, which will include your witr, and then you may pray later on at night, 2 by 2 by 2, without praying witr again. Shaykh bin Baz rahimahullah suggested that when the Imam does taslim, and during the last rak'ah, you get up in order to make it 12. Right? And so you have not really, you prayed with the Imam, you got that benefit, but you did not pray your odd numbers, so when you go back home, you may pray some more and conclude with an odd number. Again, this is if you are of the position that you may increase or go beyond 11, but this is a whole other discussion. So, we get engaged, بإذن الله عز وجل, by the tawfiq of Allah, success granted by Him in some worship during that time. Of course, needless to say, you're alone. You know, there's no one looking at you. You're not trying to impress anyone. You're not trying to get the praise of anyone, which is what the shaitan often tries to do to us. May Allah protect us from him. So this is time where you are in seclusion with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the sense that you don't have anyone bothering you or disturbing you. You finish the salah, you approach what is known as as-sahar, which is the pre-dawn, before fajr. And this is where the word suhoor comes from. Now, in partaking in suhoor is a very blessed act of worship. And the hadith of Abu Sa'id Al-Khudri in the Musnad of Imam Ahmad, which was authenticated by Al-Bani rahimahullah also, he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as-suhuru baraka. Wa fi riwayah as-suhuru kulluhu baraka. Fala tada'u. Walau an yajra'a ahadukum jara'atan min ma' fa'inna allaha wa malaikatahu yusalluna ala mutasahhirin. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, suhoor is all blessings, so do not neglect it. Even if one of you was to take a mouthful of water, then let him do so, because Allah and His angels yusalloon upon those who partake in suhoor. Now, yusalloon, the meaning changes in reference to whom we're speaking about. So when we say Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala yusalli ala al-abd, which you think that it is just regular prayer, actually the scholars like Ibn Qayyim al-Jawziyyah rahimahullah mentions that means that Allah will boast about this servant, and he will mention him and praise him among the angels that are nearest to him. So your name will be mentioned above the seven heavens. Your name will be mentioned around the angels that are closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When the angels do salah upon a slave, then they merely ask Allah to forgive him and have mercy on him. They make dua for you. Now, if you partake in suhoor, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His angels, you'll be receiving Allah's praise, and then the angels will ask Allah to forgive you and have mercy on you for getting up and partaking in the meal of suhoor. Now, the time is not what is often done. I remember back in my home country, when we were young, our suhoor was at 11 before midnight. We'll have dinner, and then we call that suhoor, you know, and then, you know, we just wake up the next day at dhuhr time. This is before Allah guided us to practice the deen. Suhoor actually is not something that you do midnight or 1 in the morning or something like that. You may, of course, but the sunnah is that you do it towards just before Fajr, just before the entrance of Fajr. In the hadith which was muttafaqun alayh, the hadith of Zayd ibn Thabit radiallahu anhu, he said, تسحرنا مع رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ثم قمنا إلى الصلاة فقيل كم كان قدر ذلك قال 50 آية. He said we had suhoor with the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم, then we went and we prayed. He was asked how long was the duration between your suhoor and the salah. He said approximately 50 ayahs. يعني what it will take you to recite 50 verses of the book of Allah, this should be the time between your suhoor and the salah. Not what you see today on many of the calendars where they have added an extra column called imsak. I just got this in the email. I thought this was only back home, but I'm shocked that people from here send these kind of emails. A calendar, PDF calendar that has imsak 10 minutes before Fajr. Even though Allah says, وَكُلُوا وَاشْرَبُوا حَتَّى يَتَبَيَّنَ لَكُمُ الْخَيْطُ الْأَبْيَضُ مِنَ الْخَيْطِ الْأَسْوَدِ مِنَ الْفَجْرِ. And eat and drink until the white thread becomes clear to you from the black one, which is the entrance of Fajr. It is not 10 minutes before Fajr, it is 50 ayat or even lesser than that before Fajr. So then we should delay it to the best of our ability. Now what do you eat? You may eat kamsa if you like, and you may eat full in tamiz if you wish. You may eat whatever you like. But there has been a particular fruit that the Prophet ﷺ suggested. And an authentic narration in Ibn Majah, the Prophet ﷺ said, نِعْمَ سُحُورِ الْمُؤْمِنِ التَّمَرُ. What an excellent suhoor for the believer are dates. Dates. So having dates, needless to say, according to the, you know, the doctors, the nutritious value of dates and the sugar, the natural sugar that it contains, and the fact that it's on the stomach, it's easy. It has a number of things that you have probably read about, which really help you endure during the day and help you carry on in fasting and have enough energy, inshallah, not to sleep the whole day, which we will be dealing with later on. This is a whole other discussion. Allahu musta'an. Tayyib, you've done your suhoor, everything seems to be good. There's an act of worship that many people are heedless about, or they really don't know about, which is that of intention. Do you just fast without intending to do so? No, unless it is voluntary. If it is a voluntary fasting, the Prophet ﷺ, for instance, would wake up in the morning, or he would come home if he hadn't eaten yet, and he would ask his wives, do you have anything for food, any food? They would say no. He said, okay, I'm fasting today. Now this is when involuntary fast. But in obligatory fast, this is not the case. And the hadith of Hafsa bint Umar in Sahih Ibn Majah by Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah, the Prophet ﷺ said, لا صيام لمن لم يفرضه من الليل. There is no fast for the one who does not express his intention at night. And I don't mean by express a verbal expression. I mean that you just intend it in your heart. So in fact, you should have the intention to fast prior to the break of dawn, prior to Fajr. It doesn't have to be, there's no particular verbatim that you say, as many of the people do, نويت أن أصوم يوم الاثنين إلى آخره. None of this stuff. You don't have to say, I intend on fasting. Allah knows. Actually, the very act of waking up to have suhoor is the intention. Because I don't think any one of us usually has breakfast at 4 in the morning, unless you work right after. Usually you have breakfast when you wake up. So the very act of waking up is the intention in and within itself. Or if you don't think you're going to wake up for suhoor, or you're afraid, just the mere idea that you have that tomorrow I'm fasting is the intention. But you must have an intention. Now, some of the scholars suggested that one intention suffices the whole month. But this hadith does not support that. Because this hadith indicates that you should have one for every day that you intend on fasting. So to be on the safe side, every night before the coming of the next day, you have the intention in your heart, in your mind, there's nothing beyond that, that you will be fasting the following day, bi-idhnillahi azza wa jal. طيب. So the intention is there, you hear the call for the adhan. Now, brothers and sisters, we know that Allah has made a distinction between the males and the females in our deen. There are things, there are aspects of the deen which we share, and there are many other aspects which we don't. One of which is that of the jama'ah, the congregational prayer. We are not the same. In the case of the sisters, it is preferred for her to pray at home, even though it's allowed for her to go to the masjid. But if she's looking for the ultimate reward, then her prayer at home is where the reward is. But however, in my case and yours, it's the opposite. You cannot pray at home, you know, unless you have an excuse. The place of prayer is in the masjid. Allah says in the Quran, فِي بُيُوتٍ أَذِنَ اللَّهُ أَنْ تُرْفَعْ وَيُذْكَرَ فِيهَا اسْمُهُ يُسَبِّحُ لَهُ فِيهَا بِالْغُدُوِّ وَالْأَصَارِ رِجَالٍ لا تليهم تجارة ولا بيع عن ذكر الله وإقام الصلاة وإيتاء الزكاة يخافون يوما تتقلب فيه القلوب والأبصار ليجزيهم الله أحسن ما عملوا ويزيدهم من فضله والله يرزق من يشاء بغير حساب. Allah says interpretation of the meaning in English, in homes or houses, constructions which Allah had ordered to be raised, where His name is being glorified, He's being remembered in these places during the morning and the evening. By who? By men. The ayah says, رجال, plural of رجل, men who neither trade nor sell, distract them or divert them from the remembrance of Allah and establishing the salah and paying the zakah. Why? They are afraid of a day where the eyes and the hearts will be turned over, because of the torment of and the greatness of the Day of Judgment. For Allah to reward them according to the best of their deeds and increase them from His grace and bounty. And verily Allah grants that to whomever He wills without any measure, without any limitation. In these homes, the masajid. Abu Huraira narrated in the hadith of Muslim, قال, أَتَى النَّبِيَّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ رَجُلٌ أَعْمَى رجل أعمى قال ليس لي قائد يقودني إلى الصلاة فاستأذن من النبي عليه الصلاة والسلام أن يأذن له فيصلي في بيته فأذن له عليه الصلاة والسلام فلما ولى ناداه قال أتسمع النداء بالصلاة قال نعم قال فأجب. أبو هريرة said a blind man came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and told him, I do not have any guide to take me to the salah. Now you have to imagine the Arabian Peninsula before they had all these buildings and constructions, what it was like in the desert to go to the masjid. And according to other narrations, he was far. He was far. And he told the Messenger of Allah, I'm blind. There's no one who can guide me to the masjid, to the salah. So he was seeking a concession from the Prophet ﷺ to allow him to pray at home. Now the merciful Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, the merciful messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, he initially agreed and he allowed him, he gave him the concession. Then when the man was walking away, he called him. He said, do you hear the call for the prayer? The man said, yes. He said, فَأَجِبْ, then respond. Then respond. A blind man was not allowed to pray at home. In the hadith of Ibn Umar also, a sahih hadith, by Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah, in Irwa al-Ghalil, I believe, the Prophet said, Salatul jama'ati tafduru salatul faddi bi 27 daraja. The salah in congregation exceeds the salah in reward of the individual by 27 times. 27 times the reward. Let me give you a practical example. You go to Darub, and they have a special offer. Buy one toothpaste and get 27 for free. Now if you brush your teeth once a week, that's enough for a lifetime, probably. If you brush more than that, then you may need to buy some at some point in time. But 27 toothpaste for the price of one. Would you go to the Bagala to the local grocery store and buy, you know, for 5 riyals one toothpaste, or would you go to Danu and get 27 for free? I doubt any one of us will go to the grocery store. We may even stand in line at the Danu so we can get 27 times the reward. Now you say this to a brother today, Allah will give you 27 times the reward, the prayer that you have at home. This is if you have an excuse. If you have an excuse to pray at home. If you don't have an excuse, then you should be in the masjid. But assuming someone lives far from the masjid, he cannot hear the adhan, because the Prophet ﷺ said, do you hear the adhan? The blind man said yes, he said then respond. And the scholars say based on this hadith, it is a matter of hearing or not. And not with the speakers, with the person's real life voice. Nonetheless, point being, 27 times is the reward in the jama'ah. So it is not befitting, brothers in Islam, that one of us will be praying at home Fajr. It is not befitting. Actually, the Prophet ﷺ said this is the salah of the mudafir. This is the salah of the hypocrite. It's difficult for the hypocrite to be praying Fajr in the jama'ah. So inshallah ta'ala, with this reminder, each and every one of us will make sure that he is in the first row. Not in the second jama'ah, third jama'ah, fourth, if they have it in your local masjid, which they do nowadays. Jama'ah continue to be made, maybe till dhuhr. People's jama'ah after jama'ah. What happened, man? There's supposed to be one jama'ah, which we're all supposed to partake in. Barakallahu fiik. Which we're all supposed to partake in, the initial, original, one and only jama'ah. The other one, even some of the scholars don't allow it. They don't even allow a second jama'ah because it divides the Muslims. But Allah musta'an, let's say there's a difference of opinion, which there is. We're not supposed to depend on the second jama'ah, we're supposed to depend on the first. And to be in the first row in particular, barakallahu fiik. The Prophet ﷺ mentioned another hadith, if the people knew what was awaiting them from reward in the first row and they had no choice but to draw lots in order to get that spot in the first row, they would have done so. They would have done so. The most blessed of rows are the front rows. So inshallah we'll be just there. طيب. You've done so, right? You've prayed this salah in jama'ah with khushu', which we will deal with inshallah. It is recommended that you remain in the masjid until Ishraq or sunrise. And this is based on the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. من صلى الجماعة من صلى الغداة في جماعة ثم قعد يذكر الله حتى تطلع الشمس ثم صلى ركعتين كانت له كأجر حجة وعمرة تامة تامة تامة. وقد اختلف العلماء في صحة هذا الحديث، منهم من حسنه ومنهم من ضعفه، وكان ممن حسنه الشيخ الألباني رحمه الله تعالى إن صحيح سنن الترمذي. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, whoever prays Fajr in a jama'ah and he remains therein in the masjid until the sun rises, remembering Allah, he remains in the remembrance of Allah until the sun rises, then he gets up and he prays 2 rak'at, then it will be equal in reward to a Hajj and Umrah complete, complete, complete. This hadith, there has been a difference of opinion concerning the authenticity of this narration. Some said it's sahih, some said it's not. Al-Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah ta'ala, he said that this hadith is hasan, it's good. It has a good chain of narration. If you accept the grading of Shaykh al-Albani rahimahullah, then you may act upon this particular hadith. You will have the reward of Hajj and Umrah, complete, complete, complete. That does not mean that if you have not done your Hajj of Islam, that you no longer have to do Hajj, because you do it every morning in your local masjid. You still have to do the one-time Hajj in your life, and same thing can be said about Umrah. Just in case there's any misconceptions concerning that. طيب. So you remain in the masjid, and you're finished with your dhikr, you pray the 2 rak'at, inshallah you get the reward. Now we have the disaster. We have 2 disasters that we'll have in the lecture. This would be the first disaster. Some people will actually go to sleep from that time until Maghrib. You know, long sleep, no Dhuhr, no Asr, no nothing. And this is amazing. It amazes the individual who observes the condition of some of the Muslims today. Nasallahu alayhi wa sallam. How one can understand the objective of fasting, which Allah says in concerning that in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا كُتِبَ عَلَيْكُمُ الصِّيَامُ كَمَا كُتِبَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. Everybody knows the ayah. All you believe, fasting has been prescribed for you, as it was prescribed for those who came before you. Perhaps you may attain taqwa. I mean, there's an objective which is to do what Allah commanded and stay away from what He forbade, for you to enhance your relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to be a better believer, to attain taqwa, which will bring multiple benefits in this life and in the life to come. And this is a whole other lecture about the virtues and the benefits of taqwa. But ideally, you are fasting so you may attain taqwa. Now, what kind of taqwa does one attain when he sleeps from Fajr till Maghrib? Absolutely nothing. And so we learned from the ahadith, which I will mention a few of them for you, bi'idhnillah azza wa jal, that there's more to it. It is not just the abstinence from eating and drinking and relation with one's spouse. Rather, this has been negated and by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who said, مَنْ لَمْ يَدَعْ قَوْلَ الزُّورِ وَالْعَمَلَ بِهِ فَلَيْسَ لِلَّهِ تَعَالَى حَاجَةٌ فِي أَنْ يَدَعَ طَعَامَهُ وَشَرَابَهُ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever does not abandon false speech and acting according to it, false actions, then Allah is in no need for him to leave alone food and drink. If you're going to be a wicked Muslim during the day while you're fasting, then Allah does not need you to go on a diet. The objective of fasting is not simply losing weight, as it is the case with some. The main objective of fasting is to attain taqwa. The Prophet ﷺ said another authentic narration, which is authenticated by Al-Albani rahimahullah, رُبَّ صَائِمٍ لَيْسَ لَهُ مِنْ صِيَامِهِ إِلَّا الْجُوعُ وَالْعَطَشُ. Perhaps a fasting individual will attain nothing from his fast except hunger and thirst. يعني you will get nothing except being hungry and thirsty. And it is inevitably beyond that. And the hadith of Abu Huraira, which is in Bukhari, the hadith Qudsi, Allah Jalla Jalaluhu says, كل عمل ابن آدم له إلا الصيام فإنه لي وأنا أجزي به والصيام جنة وإذا كان يوم صوم أحدكم فلا يرفث ولا يجهل فإن سابه أحد أو قاتله فليقل إني امرؤ صام إني امرؤ صائم فوالذي نفسي فوالذي نفس محمد بيده صلى الله عليه وسلم لخلوف فم الصائم أطيب عند الله من ريح المسك وللصائم فرحتان يفرحهما إذا أفطر فرح وإذا لقي ربه فرح بصومه. The Prophet ﷺ said in a hadith Qudsi, which is a hadith that is from Allah Azza wa Jal, but it is not like the verses in the Quran expressed by the Prophet ﷺ. He said, Allah says, all of the deeds of the children of Adam belong to them. Except for fasting, it is mine, and I reward accordingly. So when Allah says that, you cannot even imagine what that entails. What is prepared from reward, we cannot even imagine. Because Allah says, فَإِنَّهُ لِي, it is mine, وَأَنَا أَجْزِي بِهِ, and I will reward accordingly. Then He said, fasting is protection from the hellfire and from sins. That's an addition. The hadith says, fasting is a protection, according to the ulama, from the hellfire and from disobedience and sins. Then the hadith continues to say, if it happens to be a day where one of you is fasting, let him not have a relation with his spouse, and let him not act ignorantly. And if someone was to verbally abuse you or fight you, then say, verily, I am a fasting individual. Meaning, I will not go down to your level. You're reminding yourself and you're reminding this person that you are in a state of worship to Allah. You will not fight back, and you will not return the evil with evil. Rather, you will remain steadfast so you may attain the ultimate benefit from your fasting. Then the Prophet ﷺ said, and verily the smell emanating from the fasting person's mouth is more dear and pleasant to Allah than the smell of musk. And the fasting person will have two joys that he will enjoy. One, when he breaks his fast, and you know how happy we are, when you see the sambusa and all the good stuff, and another one when he meets his Lord because of his fasting. So all these narrations, brothers and sisters in Islam, indicate that fasting is not simply a ritual, as it is the case with the Jews and the Christians and people of other faith, where they just do whatever they do because it's a habit. And so our acts of worship are dynamic, they're live, they must be feelings and spirituality alongside with them. Otherwise, we're not really getting what we are supposed to get, which is the taqwa that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had suggested in this particular ayah. طيب. So, you're not going to sleep the whole day, inshallah. You get some rest, because you need the rest. You may go back to sleep, but يعني maximum dhuhr time you should be up and running, ready for the salah. And you know, you don't wait for the adhan to wake up, because by the time you wake up and you go to the bathroom and you make wudu, you've missed the jama'ah. Or at least you've missed the first few rows. So obviously you wake up before dhuhr, so at the time of salah you would be also at the masjid bi'idhnillahi azza wa jal. Now I will enumerate a number of acts of worship that one may partake in during the day. If you have gotten the reward of Umrah and Hajj in the morning, then that's good. But if you really want to do Umrah, then in a hadith in Bukhari, where a woman had missed, the Prophet ﷺ told her, what prevented you from doing Hajj with us? She said that she gave him an excuse. He said, فَإِذَا جَاءَ رَمَضَانَ فَاعْتَمِرِي فَإِنَّ عُمْرَةً فِيهِ تَعْدِلُ حَجَّةً وَفِي رِوَايَةٍ لِمُسْلِمْ حَجَّةً مَعِي. A woman had, the Prophet ﷺ asked the woman, why did she not perform Hajj with him? She gave him a valid excuse. He told her, hadith is in Bukhari, if Ramadan arrives, then perform a Umrah. Verily, a Umrah in Ramadan is equal to Hajj. And in the narration in Sahih Muslim, a Hajj with me. A Hajj with the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it is highly recommended that you do at least one Umrah in the month of Ramadan. But don't go on the 27th. Shaykh bin Uthaymeen rahimahullah ta'ala, in the sharh of Juz' Amma, he made a very interesting comment concerning this act of that is done by many people that were on the 27th, which is assumed to be Laylatul Qadr, they insist on doing Umrah on that night, thinking that there's a special virtue. He, rahimahullah, said, actually, the seerah, the biography of the Prophet ﷺ, opposes that. We have indications that many years he was around in Mecca, or he had the chance to do Umrah on that particular night, and he never did so. So the sunnah is whenever he, alayhi salatu wasalam, could have done something, but he deliberately left it alone, then the sunnah becomes that you leave it alone. Raising the hands after the salah. A very common practice, right? The Prophet sallam had 23 years to raise his hands once after a congregational prayer or otherwise and make dua. Many, many opportunities for him to do so, which would be narrated to us from the companions, his wives, or otherwise. But through, the fact is, all of these years, there's not even a single narration which indicates that. So the scholars say that the sunnah becomes that you don't do that, because he could have done that, but he didn't. So then you don't do that, that is the sunnah. If you are to raise your hands, now you're going against the sunnah. Because he could have done that, but he didn't. I'm not saying raising the hands altogether is not from the sunnah. We're speaking about after particular acts of worship, such as salah, the congregational salah. So then you don't have to do it on the 27th of Ramadan. If Allah decreed that that's the only day you have time, alhamdulillah. But in your heart, do not intend that because of the virtue of Laylatul Qadr, assuming that it is Laylatul Qadr, that I would like to do Umrah on that particular night. Because this is, Shaykh bin Uthaymeen said, this is a bid'ah. This is an innovation, a reprehensible innovation. طيب. Then, let's say you did Umrah between Fajr and Dhuhr, you know, if you were able to do so one of these days. What else can you do during the day after you have gotten your rest? You can remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ ذِكْرًا كَثِيرًا. Allah incited us in the Quran subhanahu wa ta'ala, interpretation of the meaning in English. All you who believe, remember Allah abundantly. And the remembrance of Allah is something that one can do anytime, with the exception of the restroom. But otherwise, anytime, even if you are in a state of janaba, in impurity, you may still remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Aisha said, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would remember Allah all the times. And so, you can remember Allah as often as you want, both by using the tongue and by being mindful of Allah. Remembering Allah is not only saying Subhanallah, Alhamdulillah, where you know, we do some exercise, you know, this kind of speedy kind of act that is not really befitting. Because Subhanallah is a big deal. You're saying, glory be to Allah. High above is Allah in perfections and deficiencies. It's a very strong, powerful meaning. So it is not befitting a believer after the Salah saying, You see, you know, just exercising his finger muscles, and it's just, you know, all he hears is pss, pss, pss. You are remembering Allah. Subhanallah. Subhanallah. Think about it. Subhanallah. Alhamdulillah. So on and so forth. Similarly, when we remember Allah, with our tongues and with our minds, with our hearts, we should be mindful of Allah. It is not some heavy load you're trying to throw off your shoulders so you can go on with your day. We should strive, if we are unable to do this because of our sins. Being very frank, because of our sins, because of our hearts and the diseases that we have in our hearts. That's why we don't enjoy the remembrance of Allah. But nonetheless, we should strive to take our time, be patient in doing so, and ask Allah to purify our hearts from the illnesses and diseases, so we may be like the righteous predecessors who used to enjoy worshipping Allah. It wasn't a burden. It was an honor and pleasure. And inshallah, we would like to follow the footsteps. طيب, recitation of the Quran. And we know the virtue of the Quran. Now, our righteous predecessors used to be amazing individuals. Al-Aswad, rahimahullah, used to recite the Quran every two nights. He would finish the Quran every two nights. These are all authentic narrations, inshallah. Mujahid used to finish it every single night. Every single night. Now, people wonder, do I have to do khatm? Is it necessary that I finish the Quran once? Or that it's done in a jama'ah, in the taraweeh? The scholars say no. It is not compulsory for you to finish the Quran, but you're missing out on major rewards. And from the way of the righteous predecessors, we understand from the a'imma and others that they used to recite the Quran abundantly. Sufyan al-Thawri, a muhaddith, used to abandon the circles of knowledge and the hadith, and he would dedicate his time to the recitation of the Book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So you can recite the Quran as much as you want. But why do we recite the Quran? Are we like those whom Allah said about, وَمِنْهُمْ أُمِّيُّونَ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ الْكِتَابَ إِلَّا أَمَانِي? When Allah wanted to criticize the Jews and the Christians, He said, and among them are those who are illiterate. They know nothing of the book but recitation. They know nothing of their book but recitation. So it is not about reciting where somebody says, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen, Alhamdulillah, Rabbil Alameen. No, slow down, Habibi. You're not, there's no objective, there's no goal. Yes, من قرأ حرفا من كتاب الله فله به حسنة والحسنة بعشر أمثالها لا أقول ألف لا ميم حرف ولكن ألف حرف ولا من حرف وميم حرف. The hadith of Sahih Tirmidhi, which is authentic from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that whoever recites a letter from the book of Allah will have 10 good deeds accordingly. And will have one deed, and the deed is multiplied into 10. And Allah multiplies more to whomever He wills. So I don't say alif, lam, mim is one harf, one letter. Rather, alif is a letter, lam is a letter, and mim is a letter. So three letters are 30 good deeds by saying alif, lam, mim. Even though we understand that, we have to understand this in the light of their righteous predecessors, their way of life. Like Ibn Umar, who it took him eight years to memorize Surah Al-Baqarah. 8 years! To memorize Surah Al-Baqarah, because he wasn't just trying to recite. The brother was learning everything that it contained of knowledge. Similarly, Allah says, كِتَابٌ أَنْزَلْنَاهُ إِلَيْكَ مُبَارَكٌ لِيَتَّبَّرُوا آيَاتِهِ وَلِيَتَذَكَّرَ أُولُو الْأَلْبَابِ. A book we have sent down upon you, Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, blessed. Why? So they may ponder and reflect upon his verses, and the people of understanding will take a reminder. So the objective of the Qur'an is that it leads you to Allah. We don't want to get involved in simply reciting without understanding. So if you understand Arabic, alhamdulillah, read slowly. If you don't, Allah has blessed us with the interpretation of the meanings being translated into the many languages that we speak. So you may read the Quran. Concerning that, Imam al-Nawawi, rahimahullah, made a very interesting comment. He said, even though we read this from our righteous predecessors, that does not mean that you just do nothing but recite the Quran. He said, rather, if one is involved in other acts of worship, such as things which will benefit the community, or a lecture, or da'wah, then each will act accordingly. This is for the one who has absolutely nothing else to do, he may read the Quran in this fashion. But for the rest, it is not necessary that we all do, you know, so many number of khatm in the month of Ramadan. Rather, you may be involved in an act of worship which supersedes the recitation of the Quran, because it is يعني نفع متعدد, as the scholars call it. It is benefit which supersedes the individual. It reaches out to others. So he gets good deeds and they get good deeds as well. So this recitation of the Quran is relevant to the individual. Whatever the case may be, we want to understand what we are reciting because it's the speech of Allah. He's addressing us and He's telling us what we need to do, how we should live our life, when to fear Him, what to stay away from, and what to fulfill as obligations. And if you just read a book, if you bring a book for me right now in Chinese, and I sit here and I learn how to read Chinese for whatever reason, and I just read Chinese for you for an hour, and I don't understand Chinese and neither do you. I mean, what are we doing? Somebody will throw a tomato at me if they have one. Because, you know, what are you doing? You bring a Chinese man, you know we don't understand Chinese, and you don't even understand Chinese to translate to English. So we say, this is foolishness. And, you know, everybody will agree. So we cannot just read the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without knowing what is intended. Give some time for reading the tafsir or reading the interpretation of the meaning in your language so you may understand. And if the imam of your masjid is following a particular a procedure in his salah where he recites from the juzu, or you can know from him what he will be reciting during the night, then do so. So you can go home, read what will be recited in a language which you understand, so when you are standing in the salah and you hear something that you know, you will be affected. You will be affected with the Quran. You will know, oh, I know what this ayah means. Otherwise, it's difficult to stand in the salah without knowing what is being said. Alhamdulillah, some brothers still manage to cry because of the effect of the Quran on the hearts of the believers. But if we were to understand, it would be way beyond that. We will really enjoy. And so this is something that we're all encouraged to do. Another act of worship which we may partake in is sabaqa. There's a weak narration that is very commonly spread through email and otherwise, that the Prophet ﷺ said that the best sabaqa is the one given in Ramadan. This is inauthentic. But we have in the hadith of Ibn Abbas, where he said, كَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَجْوَدَ النَّاسِ وَكَانَ أَجْوَدُ مَا يَكُونُ فِي رَمَضَانِ حِنَ يَلْقَاهُ جِبْرِيلِ وَكَانَ يَلْقَاهُ جِبْرِيلِ فِي كُلِّ لَيْلَةِ مِنْ رَمَضَانِ فَيُدَارِسُهُ الْقُرْآنِ فَلَى رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ أَجْوَدُ بِالْخَيْرِ مِنَ الْرِّيحِ الْمُرْسَلَةِ. In this authentic narration, Ibn Abbas said, the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم was the most generous of people. In his daily life, he was the most generous of people. And he will be more generous in Ramadan. Jibreel will come and he will go over the Quran and review it with him. And he will come to him every night. And verily, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was more generous with goodness than the fair wind, which Allah sends with the rain and the benefit for the people. So being generous in Ramadan is only befitting, especially when you're hungry and you have an empty stomach. And you get to feel for the first time in maybe months how hunger feels. And then you think about the Muslims, disregard the non-Muslims for a moment, the Muslim brothers and sisters all over the world who have nothing to eat. And they go to sleep at night without the choice of fasting, but they fast because they have no choice. They have no food to eat. So when we are feeling this kind of hunger, perhaps we become more compassionate. And we will sympathize with the brothers and sisters in Islam, and then we will spend accordingly. Be it in your country back home, where people may be more needy, or people over here, whatever the case, but you know, make sure that you investigate before you give your money to someone. Not everyone that you see in the street deserves your money. And not everyone that comes into the masjid and speaks after the salah deserves your money. Wal'iyadu billah, some of these people have taken this as a business. So if you want to put your money in a place, make sure you look for the masakeen. And the poor people, the real people who are striving but don't have enough income to survive, these are the people that should be most deserving of our sadaqat in Ramadan and otherwise. Tayyib, we're approaching the end, don't worry. Iftar, you're just around the time of Iftar, which is the second disaster, just wait a little bit inshaAllah. And the hadith of Abu Hurairah, which was the Sahih al-Majah, the Prophet ﷺ said, ثَلَاثَةٌ لَا تُرَدُّ دَعْوَتُهُمْ. He mentioned among them, وَالصَّائِمُ حَتَّى يُفْتَرُ. There are three whose supplication will never be rejected. And he mentioned one of them, the fasting person, until he breaks his fast. So it is recommended that you make some dua before you break your fast, because بِإِذْنِ عَزَّ وَجَلْ inshaAllah, it will be accepted by Allah. Now we know from other narration that not every dua will be given just like you like it. You may want the Mercedes. And then you say, well, Allah, I made dua every night in Ramadan and I'm still driving a Toyota Tercel. And so where's my Mercedes? We say, we have from another narration that when you make dua, one of three things happen. Either Allah will give you that, which you want, if it is good for you. But maybe this Mercedes will keep you away from the Masjid, so Allah will not give it to you as a mercy to you. Or Allah will alleviate some calamity that was supposed to befall you according to your dua. So some calamity was going to befall you, because of your dua, it will no longer come. Or Allah will save it for you until the day of judgment. One of three things. So just if you ask for something and you don't get it, it does not mean that Allah did not respond to your supplication. So you make dua. Now it is highly recommended that you provide someone with a meal. The hadith of Ibn Sa'id al-Juhni, radiallahu anhu wa arda, he said, the Prophet said, مَنْ فَطَّرَ صَائِمًا كَانَ لَهُ مِثْلُ أَجْرِهِ غَيْرَ أَنَّهُ لَا يَنْقُصُ مِنْ أَجْرِ الصَّائِمِ شَيْئًا. Whoever provides a fasting person with a meal, he will have a reward equal to the one fasting. Yet, that will not decrease the reward of the fasting person that he spent. Meaning, someone goes through the whole day struggling and striving in his fast, gaining an abundance of reward, and you give him a meal, Allah will give you his whole reward. This is beautiful. This is an excellent opportunity to do so. So if you're able to host a particular iftar one of these days, or whether financially or at your house, whatever the case may be, you are the one who provides the people with their meal, then this is an opportunity to get near to Allah and to get the reward of all those who are fasting during the day. And I cannot think of any better deal during that time. طيب. What do you break your fast with? And how soon do you do so? And the hadith which is authentic, the hadith in Sahih al-Tirmidhi, hadith of Abu Hurairah, the Prophet ﷺ said in the hadith Qudsi, أَحَبُّ عِبَادِي إِلَيَّ أَعْجَلُهُمْ فِطْرًا. Allah says, the most beloved of my servant to me are those who hasten to break their fast. So as soon as you hear the adhan, you should be chewing on a date. Preferably, based on the hadith of Anas رضي الله عنه, a fresh date. The ripe, the ones, the ones that are just sticky and stuff like that. If you cannot find those, then the dry date. If you cannot find those, then just some water. But preferably fresh, ripe dates to break your iftar with, as it was the way of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he said, "Wala yazalu an-nasu bi khayrin ma'ajjal al-fitr." My ummah, the people remain in a state of goodness so long that they hasten to break their fast. So don't be, you know, this called fake wara and fake khushu', and you know somebody's trying to be Sheikh al-Islam at the time of iftar. Well, everybody's breaking the fast. Brother, I like to pray Maghrib first. Habibi, this is time for you to eat. Okay, we have some individuals that want to go to extreme, say, I will break my fast after the Salah, because the Salah is important, and I don't want to have the taste of dates in my mouth, and they give you all kinds of rational justifications, which are unacceptable in Islam. The Prophet ﷺ used to break his fast as soon as the Adhan is called, then he would pray Maghrib. And so, we should do so. Now the second disaster. How much do you eat? Some of us believe, probably, that night will be the last time they ever eat. Probably the last time they will ever eat. You'll see some brothers maybe carrying a plate that needs three other people to help them. Say, please, can you take the other edge? Barakallah feek, you know, plate like this, stuffed with rice and chicken and sambusa and so on and so forth. And you know, brother, where you going? This is for your family, for the tribe? No, this is for me. MashaAllah, tabarakallah. Now what happens? You find out we eat, you know, half a chicken, and then the rest you find it in the trash. So I would like to make a reminder here for myself and for you. This is not befitting. It is the month of fasting, not the month of eating. You know, it's amazing how our condition of the Muslims have changed. Can you imagine during the time of the Sahaba, all these special juices coming, special sambusa, food that you usually don't have throughout the year, suddenly pops up in Ramadan. And you cannot go to the local market anymore because it's just, you know, everybody's getting food. But it's a month of fasting. We're supposed to be fasting. Now we eat, alhamdulillah, but with moderation. The general expression is, take it easy. Take it easy when it's time to break the fast. If you eat too much, the very next thing that will happen is that you'll become sleepy. And you try to pray Taraweeh while being sleepy. It's horrible. You'll be standing in the Salah, yawning, and you know, wishing the Imam will recite less in order for you to go and get some rest. You're going to ruin your whole Ramadan by eating too much. So the suggestion is as follows. Eat very small amount of food at the time of Maghrib. Okay? Just to get you by. Just to get you by. And dates is very good because the sugar immediately goes through the blood. It will, inshallah, rejuvenate you or whatever that word is. But then postpone the real deal food till after Taraweeh. The real food, if you want to eat, yani, majorly, you do it after Taraweeh. Still, you cannot forget the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ that the worst vessel the son of Adam fills is his stomach. It is sufficient for the son of Adam a few bites to keep him going. If it is inevitable that you want to eat so much, then it's one third for food, one third for water, and one third for your breath. So if you've eaten to the extent that you cannot breathe anymore, we did not need one third for breath. And that's obvious. And sometimes not only we can't breathe, we can't even move. You know, the brothers after food say, "Akhi, can you please, you know, help me get up?" So in Ramadan particularly, we want to take it easy. Eat enough to get by, pray Taraweeh, finish the ibadah, then go home and bismillah. Then you eat accordingly, you have a whole night to digest that. And I, of course, you're not going to wake up the whole night as it is the habit of the people. You will go to sleep, inshallah. But in case because of the situation or the work hours that they force you to work, you know, wake up throughout the night, then Allah musta'an. But anyways, there's plenty of time for us to digest the food as opposed to eating it all during Maghrib. Last but not least, Qiyam. حديث أبو هريرة البخاري مسلم من قام رمضان إيمانا واحتسابا غفر له ما تقدم من ذنبه. Whoever prays Ramadan at night with the Imam, belief, due to his belief in Allah and seeking the reward from Allah, then he will have all of his past sins forgiven. All of the sins will be forgiven bi-idhnillah. That's a big deal because of the many sins that we commit. For all of these sins to be forgiven, because of standing up for some few minutes every night, the Sahaba used to pray for hours, ya akhwan. They called it Taraweeh because they had to rest. Some of them you had to use a cane and lean on a cane so they may remain in line. Nowadays, within an hour from Isha, all of the masajid have concluded their salah. And so we really want to bring to mind the following. Brother and sister, brother in particular, Allah has honored you that He allowed you to come to one of His houses to worship Him during the night. You have to understand, this is an honor bestowed upon us from Allah. He deprived billions of people that He allowed to prostrate to the sun and to the moon and to Jesus and to the angels and to Buddha and to cows and monkeys and so on and so forth. But Allah chose you to worship Him in truth. So when you are in the masjid during Taraweeh, you should be mindful of the fact that Allah has given you an opportunity and a blessing that many people don't have. If the case is such, you should not be complaining while standing in Taraweeh. Now you remember when you went to Six Flags, if you know Six Flags or Magic Mountain or Disneyland, we would stand in line for an hour chatting and having a good time. Life is good. No problem. Maybe we will never complain that this is a long line. But unfortunately, as soon as we get engaged in the salah, we start complaining. And we may even backbite the imam after the salah. Ishad, what is this imam? Long ya akhi, half a page in one rak'ah. Well, we have things to do. Yeah. Subhanallah, if we were at Six Flags, nobody will complain. But when we come to the salah, we're in a place where we're supposed to be feeling honored and you know, the ultimate opportunity to gain Allah's love. We're going to start complaining, it is not befitting. But if you eat too much, you will, trust me. That's why I remind myself and you, don't eat too much, so you may pray Taraweeh accordingly. Now, remain with the Imam until he leaves. The hadith of Abu Dharr, which is sahih by Sheikh Al-Albani, مَنْ قَامَ مَعَ الْإِمَامِ حَتَّى يَنْصَرِفْ كُتِبَ لَهُ قِيَامُ لَيْلَةٍ. Whoever prays with the Imam until he leaves will have the reward of praying all night. While you're sleeping, or if you're really praying, still you will get the reward of praying all night if you remain behind the Imam. So don't leave before him. Don't leave before him. And lastly, there's something that must be running in the background, right? With all of the things that I mentioned, from the beginning of the day until the end, there's something that we cannot miss out on, we cannot ignore, and which is that of sincerity, ikhlas. Brothers, these acts of worship are not done for the sake of people, And they're not done because they are habits and customs that we have become used to because of our upbringing. It is not like that. It is not so we can also get the people's praise. So they can say, MashaAllah, Tabarakallah, A, B, C, D. No. When we leave the house, go into the salah, when we are fasting, when we are remembering Allah, when we are reciting the Quran, we should do this for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our righteous predecessors used to be amazing individuals. One of them would be on his bed crying, and his wife is right next to him and she doesn't know. His pillow would be soaked with tears, and his wife doesn't know. Another one would be praying in the salah, crying, and the brother standing next to him doesn't know. Sufyan al-Thawri said, it has reached me that a person will do a good deed, and the shaitan will continue to whisper to him so he may publicize it. And then he loses the first battle and he publicizes the deed. Then the shaitan will continue to whisper to him until he reaches the point where he wants to be praised for the deed. Then he said, then the deed will be erased from the book of good deeds, and it will be written under the book of showing off. Once you want to be praised for the deed, forget about the deed. That's Allah al-Afiyah. So then, the fasting, the praying, the remembrance of Allah, the recitation of the Quran. What the people think doesn't matter. It does not matter. What matters is that Allah knows about it, that you're doing it for a sake. So we don't want to go through the day, A, to please the people so they may be impressed, or B, because Allah, everybody fasts, so I fast. Everybody goes to Taraweeh, I go to Taraweeh. There should be a live heart feeling these acts of worship. If we do so, then all of these virtues will be applicable to us. If we do so, then whoever fasts Ramadan, whoever prays in Ramadan, out of belief in Allah, sincerity, and seeking Allah's reward, will have his past sins forgiven. And he will leave Ramadan like a newborn baby, bi-idhnillahi azza wa jal. This happens, one, when we attain taqwa, when we are mindful of the acts of worship, and when we're doing it for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in conclusion, this was the typical day for the believer according to the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to allow me and you to make it to Ramadan, then furthermore to benefit from Ramadan in the ultimate sense, and to make us among those whose sins will be forgiven and be admitted to paradise and protected from the hellfire. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Alhamdulillah wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad. The first question, it says, with the current situation with the swine flu, what shall we do with regards to going to the haram and performing Umrah in Ramadan? What advice do you give? The fatwa that I have read basically says that you have to evaluate the situation until there has been some warnings issued from the people of expertise in that field. Then one may partake and go for Umrah or Hajj and so on and so forth. And he should just depend on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and try his best, because there's no real threat or danger as of yet. If the situation changes though, then we have indications from the Quran and the Sunnah, and from the Sunnah of the Prophet particularly, that one does not go to the places where there's illnesses and diseases. If you have the disease, you don't go out, so you will not give it to the people. And if you're in a place, then you don't leave to a place where there's that illness as well. This is based on a narration which is authentic, attributed to the Sahaba of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And so what the advice would be, Allahu A'lam, if you wish to avoid doing Umrah in order to protect yourself, then we ask Allah to reward you according to your intention. But I cannot give you a fatwa whether you should go or not. You should ask the people of expertise whether it is safe to go or not. You know, the people infected are very small in numbers, and still, maybe some are more, you know, protective. Allahu A'lam. You just, you know, refer this to a scholar, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum, wa alaikum assalam, wa rahmatullah. May Allah bless you, and may Allah bless you too. How do we change our sleeping schedule so that it is in accordance with the sunnah? I'm trying to sleep after Isha and wake up early in the morning, but sometimes I don't hear my alarm clock or the adhan or even Fajr salah. Allahum sta'an. As to how to change your sleeping schedule, it is a matter of consistency. Anytime you do something, like for example, you used to have a job where you work from 9 to 5, and then you get a new job where you work the graveyard shift. Believe me, after a week, and if you get a few write-ups and you know you get in trouble with your manager, you're gonna wake up for the shift. Okay, you have to be there 5 in the morning or whatever, you will be there. You have to be there midnight, you will be there. Just like any regular job. If you do it consistently, your body will get used to that new schedule of yours and life goes on. So there's no such thing where you cannot possibly change the schedule. You can with consistency. But if one day you do it, the next day you don't, then you're not giving your body the ability to be consistent so that it may reach that level. As for not hearing the alarm clock or the adhan or even Fajr Salah, there is an alarm clock that somebody gave me as a gift that has a vibrator that you put under your pillow, you know, and there's no way that that will wake you up. So if this is what is required, you better go to the market and buy, you know, the loudest alarm, the one that comes with the vibrator, so there will be no excuse. Otherwise, you should wake up. Alarm will do the job, the adhan should do the job, a family member should help you as well. Anyways, from what we know, from the lives of our righteous predecessors who did not have any alarm clocks or anything of this nature, because of their mindfulness of Allah, their concern about the salah, they wake up by themselves. You really wake up by yourself. If you've been thinking about Fajr from the night time, if your qalb, your heart is attached to the masjid, as Prophet ﷺ described them, رَجُلٌ قَلْبُهُ مُعَلَّقٌ بِالْمَسَاجِدِ, a man whose heart is attached to the masjid, trust me, you can never sleep for a salah. Your body will not allow you. And Allah will assign through His ways, you will wake up. You will wake up for the salah. So perhaps one should look into his affair with Allah. Perhaps there are some sins or some things that are preventing the person from waking up at the time. Otherwise, a good alarm will do the job, inshallah. And you know, brothers who have tried this said it works. If the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ received the Quran over the period of 23 years, how was the Quran sent down during Ramadan? Actually, the scholars have explained this by saying the following. The Quran as the book, okay, as the whole book, was revealed in Laylatul Qadr, into the Sama' of the dunya. Then from there on, it was revealed in portions according to the circumstances of the Muslims over the period of 23 years. So the whole Quran was revealed in Laylatul Qadr, and then the actual ayat or chapters were revealed according to the situation of the Muslims over the period of 23 years. So there are two revelations. The major revelation from Allah Azza wa Jal to the lowest heaven, then the second one from Jibreel onto the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. This is how I've read most of the fatawa and the righteous predecessors and the ulama. This is how they interpret the idea that the Quran was revealed in the month of Ramadan. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. You mentioned a hadith where one gains the reward of praying the whole night if the worshipper stays until the imam leaves. Please clarify the meaning of leaving. Does it mean until the imam concludes the prayer, or does it mean until he actually exits the masjid? Actually, I've had the same issue before, and I've read conflicting opinions for the scholars on whether you should remain in the masjid until the imam, or at least remain sitting until the imam leaves, or when he simply concludes the salah. The position that was given is that from the general understanding of the deen, what is intended is that you remain with the imam until he finishes the salah. Maybe he decides to sleep in his place. And so that means everybody will have to remain in the masjid and nobody will be able to get the reward unless they stay there till Fajr because he decided to sleep in his place. So, you know, logically we say that this cannot be the case. Then the scholars say, then we understand once he's done the taslim and he's concluded the salah, then khalas, you are considered to have remained behind him until he has finished. Wallahu ta'ala. Does swallowing phlegm break the fast? If you do it on purpose, if you make, you know, what they call a lugi, I believe, and you know, you try to swallow it as means of nutrition, then if somebody has this issue, then yes, it breaks the fast. But if it is the regular saliva that one has in his mouth, which you cannot control, especially when you're thirsty, then you know, this one swallowing does not affect the fast in any way, shape, or form. You may even, wash your mouth, and you know, but as long as you don't drink anything, nothing goes into your stomach. What if the imam continuously elongates the qunut of witr? If someone leaves earlier, do they miss out on the reward of praying all the night? Yes, they do. And find another masjid where they don't do that. There are masajid where the imams are upon the sunnah, alhamdulillah. Where, you know, and we mentioned this before, it's a calamity. Imagine, I don't understand what these people think. يعني he's standing giving dua for 10-15 minutes, where the people behind him want to leave. يعني you're there for worshiping Allah. If you reach a point where you want to just to get out of the salah because of this, how is this benefiting us? Where is the essence of the ibadah? The objective of ibadah is that you feel that you're asking Allah for something. When the imam goes on and on and on, he gives you a biography. Oh Allah, have mercy on us when they carry us on the shoulder. Have mercy on us when they put us down. Have mercy on us when they put us in the grave. Have mercy on us when they put the dirt. خلاص يا أخي, it's a movie. We understand, have mercy on us when we die. خلاص, you don't have to give us the images how it is done in sequence, how someone is buried. Have mercy on... Some people go to it, يعني they don't have the right understanding of the sunnah. Unfortunately, I'm getting excited right now because we don't want anyone to go against the sunnah, but I'll calm down. The bottom line is, you pray in a place where the qunut is moderate. He may say a few things like jawami' al-kalim, comprehensive statements that include a lot of goodness, and khalas, and he doesn't do it every night. You may speak to me afterwards, I can give you a couple of messages which we tried last year. I hope that they're still alive and they're still doing this, where the imams actually were upon the sunnah and concerning the qunut. Otherwise, if you do leave, you will not get the reward. Because the hadith says that you have to remain with the imam until he leaves. But perhaps Allah will reward you if you remained, and you know, but you don't repeat it. You don't go there again with the same imam, because then you have no excuse to. Since you're talking about bid'ah, do mention the munkar of wasting food at iftar. Yes, we did mention that you know, whatever you do not eat, it doesn't belong in the trash, it belongs in a container, they call it safari, to go, okay, take out. Take it out, if you're eating at a restaurant, if it's home, of course you're gonna put it in the fridge. If you have been invited somewhere, then say, whatever I don't finish from my food, then I would kindly like to take it with me, unless you're gonna eat it afterwards. But whatever the case may be, it does not belong in the trash, this is a waste of food. I'm sure you've received these emails that the people send every day of, you know, poor people digging out the, you know, food from the trash. Young boys trying to eat leftovers from the trash. So this food that we throw away is a ni'mah from Allah. And this is not showing thankfulness in any way, shape or form by throwing it away. So inshallah, we will not waste this food. We will keep it in containers and eat it later. Worst case scenario, and you can try this. You see these ladies that are always begging in front of the masjid. Now you always have an issue. Do I give her money or not? Do I give her money or not? Because you don't know whether this is a business that she's running or that she's really a poor lady. So the best way to get out of this is to give them food. A, you're giving sabaka. B, hey, you know, there's no damages as far as you're concerned. And we've seen these ladies react very positively when given food. They appreciate it, they make dua for you, they're hungry. If they've been begging for money, here's the meal. So you can keep this food and give it to needy people that you may find in the street. And the last option are the birds and the cats. And the cats. And that's the last thing. Don't go for that first. But if all fails and the food is going bad, then at least don't just throw it in the trash. Put it somewhere where the cats or the birds may benefit from it. Second, delaying Maghrib. We also, maybe this came from the, before I mentioned that, we dealt with the delaying Maghrib and that this is unacceptable. The two ahadith we mentioned, the people will remain upon goodness as long as they hasten to break the fast. And the hadith Qudsi where Allah says, the most beloved of my servants to me are those who are the quickest to break their fast. And so, you shouldn't delay Maghrib, rather you should eat Jazakallah Khair. As soon as you hear Allahu Akbar, before he even finishes Akbar, as soon as you hear Allah, khalas, the time of Salah, he wouldn't have called the Adhan if the time has not entered. So once he starts calling the Adhan, you should be chewing on a date. Then I forgot the dua, maybe subhanAllah, that's why Allah decreed that we mention this. There's usually dua that is circulates in the email and you see it on the taqweem or the calendar, which is Allahumma laka simtu ala rizqa taftar, ذهب الظما وابتلت العروق وثبت الاجر ان شاء الله. The first portion of the hadith is inauthentic, which is اللهم لك صمت وعلى رزقك افطرت والى اخره. That part is not صحيح. The correct one is ذهب الظما وابتلت العروق. It was authenticated by Sheikh Al-Albani. ذهب الظما, the thirst has gone, وابتلت العروق, and the veins are moistened, وثبت الاجر ان شاء الله, and the reward is affirmed by the will of Allah. If Allah wills. So it's a sunnah to make that particular dua also while breaking your fast without any delay. Thirdly, collecting and giving wasted food a sabaka, that was already dealt with. if you stay with the Imam until he finished, but I don't pray at all. Example, to sit 2 rak'at. Oh, so you miss some, you mean. Then Allahu A'lam.
Suggest that when the adhan is being played, that you should listen to the adhan and that you should make a supplication at the end of the adhan.
Yes.
Okay, so if it's a month of Ramadan and I'm fasting, and I want to get the blessing of that dua, should I not wait till the adhan is finished before I offer the iftar? How do I do it in my mind?
Right.
And also, the Prophet someone said that the dua that is coming accompanied with your iftar is never rejected. Mm-hmm. And then the dua at the end of the adhan is not rejected.
Right.
So why? How do I do that?
Well, what you do, you do it the other way around. You see, the narrations dealing with the recommendation to hasten to break the fast are to be given precedence over the general narration of the dua after the adhan, because you may do that later. For example, kafaratul majlis, okay, saying after we finish the gathering, subhanakallahu bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. It is recommended that we do this while we're sitting in the majlis. But the scholars say, if you forgot to do so and you're already in your car and you're driving home already, and then you recall that you have not made this particular dua, then you may make that dua even though you're in your car, and inshallah you will attain the benefit associated with it. So in this case, you have the dua that you make after the adhan, or even repeating after the muadhin, right? And that conflicts with the hadith which recommends and incites you to hasten to break the fast. You may break your fast and still repeat after the muadhin. I've personally tried it, because it's just a date. So you may, while you're chewing, you pause the chewing for a moment, and then you say, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, for instance. And then when you're done, you may still make the dua while you're eating. So you can bring a relation between both. But if you were to do it the other way around, where you wait, you don't break your fast until you have finished the dua, some of the muaddineen who don't follow the sunnah, their dua is 6 minutes. You know, the Allah, he goes up and down, all four madahib, by the way, dislike that. And some of the madahib, they say it's haram for you to listen to this adhan, where the people turn the lafzul jalala, the word Allah, into a song. And he goes up and down, up and down, up and down, 5 minute adhan. I watch them sometimes. It's almost iqamah time and the adhan is not done. So if you were to wait this long, you have waited a long time for you to break the fast.
Okay, so when you're making your dua with the break fast.
Yes.
You break the fast first, or you make the dua first?
Well, we have narrations that indicate that as long as you're fasting, your dua is accepted. Then we have another narration that while he broke his fast, alayhi salam, he would say, ذَهَبَ الضَّمَأْ وَابْتَلَّتَ الْعُرُوبُ وَثَبَتَ الْأَجْرُ إِنْشَاءَ. So this whole period is a period of dua. Before, during, and after. إن شاء الله دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد.